Hello, today we are going to discuss about rectilinear propagation of light, that is straight line motion of light. The light ray travels in a straight line in a homogeneous isotropic medium. And we need to underline this term homogeneous and isotropic. By homogeneous isotropic, I mean all the optical properties of the medium is same or constant throughout the medium. If it is not homogeneous or isotropic, the medium is not homogeneous or isotropic, the light will eventually bend. It will not travel in a straight line. Light will also not travel in a straight line when it encounters an object that is comparable to its wavelength. It will eventually bend due to encounter of that smaller object. And we will not discuss it here. We will discuss it in optical interference, and this phenomenon is known as diffraction. We will not discuss diffraction here. We will discuss only rectilinear propagation of light, and we will deal with only straight line motion of light in this whole course. Okay. This motion of light ray produces shadows, images, and so on. To understand this, consider an example. Consider this candle. From this candle, a ray is coming. Rather, an infinite number of rays are coming. However, only a small fraction of these enter our eyes. Okay? Our brain can deduce from this single ray that the flame lies somewhere along this line of sight, at the end of this line of sight. Since we have two eyes, the second eye will deduce that the flame lies somewhere along this second line of sight. But the flame has to be at one point only. Therefore, we say that this flame should be at the intersection of these two line of sights. So you see, in this entire field of optics, we deal with tracing back rays to see their origin. And obviously, this should involve all the geometrical consideration, and that is why we call it geometrical optics and not optics itself. Let us now discuss another concept known as parallax. Parallax is the displacement or difference in the apparent position of an object when viewed with each eye separately or when viewed along two different line of sight. To understand this statement, let us consider an example. Consider this object. It is viewed by two viewpoints, viewpoint A and viewpoint B. When viewed along viewpoint A, the object is seen to have been placed in this blue background here. Okay. And when viewed along this viewpoint B, this object is seen to have been placed in this red background here. So you see that these two viewpoints differ by this angle alpha. And we call this angle alpha the displacement in these two viewpoints, and this is what parallax is, and it is caused by the separation of our eye. Obviously, our eyes are separated by few inches, that is why there is this displacement in the position of this object when viewed with two eyes separately. Okay, and why we are studying this? We are studying this to get an idea about distance of object from the eye. And how it is giving the idea of distance between object and eye. To understand this, let us consider this concept. And this concept says, the greater the distance of object from eyes, the smaller will be its parallactic displacement or vice versa. ये क्या कहना चाह रहा है? ये कहना चाह रहा है कि जितना दूर object होगा eye से, उतना ही कम उसका parallactic displacement होगा. या जितना पास object होगा eye के, उतना ही ज़्यादा उसका parallactic displacement होगा. So you can see that this is giving an insight of the distance between object and the eye. Thus, parallax is used to estimate distance between objects. Let us consider about this concept of formation of shadows. Shadows are nothing but the regions where light rays are blocked by the opaque object. By opaque means that light ray cannot pass through it. To consider this, consider an example. Assume that sun rises at 6 a.m. and sets at 6 p.m. Find the angle made by the sun rays with the horizontal or ground at 10 a.m. Also find the length of the shadow of a man 6 feet in height at this time. To solve this, consider from 6 a.m. to 6 p.m. 12 hours have been passed, and angle rotated by earth in 12 hours equal to 180 degree. From 6 a.m. to 6 p.m. when sun rises and sets, the angle rotated by earth will be 180 degree. angle between sun rays and horizontal end horizontal at 10 a.m. that is in 4 hours from 6 a.m. to 10 a.m. 4 hours have been passed, equal to angle rotated by earth in 1 hour into 4, and angle rotated by earth in 1 hour equal to 180 by 12. So 180 by 12 into 4 equal to 60 degree. This 60 degree is the angle made by the sun rays with the ground at 10 a.m. Okay, so we have completed our first part of the question. We will now look at the second part of a question, that is shadow calculation. For shadow calculation, consider the sun rays are making an angle of 60 degree at 10 a.m. with the horizontal that we have just calculated, and this man is standing here and it has a height of 6 feet. Now consider this triangle ABC, where angle BAC is equal to 60 degree, and this X is the shadow made by sun rays at 10 a.m. Now consider this triangle ABC. In this ABC, we have AB upon BC is equal to H upon X. AB upon BC is equal to H upon X, and that is equal to tan of 60 degree. Okay. And so from this we can calculate X is equal to H cot 60 degree. And H is 6, so 6 into cot 60 degree, that is equal to 2 root 3 feet. So shadow of man is 2 root 3 feet. You see that this shadow is dependent upon this angle that is made by sun rays and horizontal. So you see that shadow of man is not constant all throughout the day. As this angle will change, the shadow will also change. Shadow length varies as earth revolves around its axis. As earth revolves around its axis, the angle between sun rays and horizontal will vary, and eventually shadow will vary. We will have zero shadow or minimum shadow at 12 p.m. that is when sun is directly at our top of our head. Okay. Now we'll look into this concept of umbra and penumbra. Or this umbra and penumbra is the different region of shadows. We have dark region, extremely dark region where there is no light, and we have partial dark region where some light is reaching but not all fully dark, you know, and some part of light is reaching, some is not reaching, you know. So these are different regions of shadows, umbra and penumbra. To consider this source of light, we have two sources of light, S1 and S2, and we have this opaque object placed between S1 and S2 and this background screen where we need to form the shadow. You see that this region is completely dark because this region is not getting any light because of this opaque object. This blocks every inch of light that is reaching this region. Okay, so this is a dark region where no light is reaching, and we call this dark region as umbra, where no light is reaching. Now consider this surrounding region around this dark region. This surrounding region gets partial light from source S1 and S2 independently. At this region, light from S2 is reaching, not S1, and at this region, light from S1 is reaching, not S2, as you can see from this line of sight. Okay, so this is the region where partial light from single source is reached independently, and this region is called penumbra. So penumbra is the region where partial light, not fully light or not fully blocked light, partial light is reaching from either of the sources. We call this region as penumbra. So far we have learned about rectilinear propagation of light or straight line motion of light in this chapter. We have also learned about a concept named as parallax. We have looked into formation of shadows, how shadows are formed. We have also looked into different region of shadows, that is umbra and penumbra. So we will wrap it up here. I'll meet you into next class. Thank you.